down. I already had to give proof of my watch. Several times at the marriage supper of the Lamb, and is the only word that is sufficient to give that kind of praise, the word of hallelujah. And this song here, you know, the first time I heard it, I know Christmas is over, but it hadn't been that long. But the first time,
it's still going on Hallmark.
Is it really?
Yeah, Christmas goes all year long.
But, you know, the first time I ever heard this song, it instantly was became my favorite Christmas song. And it's simply called Christmas Hallelujah. If I miss this introduction, I'm just gonna miss the whole song. Christmas Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. She don't want me going with you. She's going anyway.
So good shot, Bruce.
Still working, folks.
Rolex, woo!
No, that's relax.
Hey, no, relax! Oh, man.
All that you got to see.
That's it? Yes, sir. Oh, man, what a blessing to be with you guys tonight. I want to tell a joke every Monday night, and tonight we're running kind of behind, not too bad, a little bit. And we took care of the business without church flipping. We sang, and we got mad, so everything went good. Yes, indeed. So here's my joke tonight. Johnny's mama looked out the window and noticed him playing church with her cat. She was so proud. He's out there preaching to that cat. He's out there leading singing to that cat, preaching to that cat. And everything was going perfect. And all of a sudden, he heard that cat making some of the awful noises of cat's name. He looked out the window and he had that cat in the swimming pool. Johnny, what in the world are you doing, son? He said, I'm baptizing this here cat. And she said, well, look, man, cats hate water. He said, he should have thought about that before he joined the church. We're going to be looking tonight at Exodus chapter 3. Exodus chapter 3. We're going to start reading in verse 8. Let's all stand together. Let's all stand together and read Exodus chapter 3. This is the burning bush. Let's begin with verse 1. Now Moses was tending the flock of Jethro, his father-in-law, the priest of Midian, and he led the flock to the back of the desert and came to Horeb, the mountain of God. And the angel of the Lord appeared to him in a flame of fire from the midst of the bush. And the angel of the Lord is the pre-incarnate Christ. It's always Jesus. It says, angel of the Lord is in all capital letters. Capital L, capital O, capital R, capital D. It's always going to be Jesus before he was born in Bethlehem. So he looked and behold, the bush was burning with fire, but the bush was not consumed. Then Moses said, I will now turn aside and see this great sight, why the bush does not burn. So when the Lord saw that he turned aside to look, God called to him from the midst of the bush and said, Moses, Moses. And he said, here I am. Then he said, do not draw near this place. Take your sandals off your feet, for the place where you're standing is holy ground. Moreover, he said to him, I am the God of your father, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob. And Moses hid his face, for he was afraid to look upon God. And the Lord said, I have surely seen the oppression of my people who are in Egypt, and have heard their cry because of their taskmasters, for I know their sorrows. So I have come down to deliver them out of the hand of the Egyptians and to bring them up from that land to a good and large land, a land flowing with milk and honey, to the place of the Canaanites and the Hittites and the Amorites and the Perizzites and the Hivites and the Jebusites and the Muscovites. Couldn't resist, I'm sorry. Now therefore, behold, the cry of the children of Israel has come to me, and I've also seen the oppression with which the Egyptians oppressed them. Come now, therefore, and I will send you Pharaoh, that you may bring my people, the children of Israel, out of Egypt. But Moses said to God, who am I that I should go to Pharaoh, and that I should bring the children of Israel out of Egypt? So he said, I will certainly be with you, and this shall be a sign to you, that I have sent you. When I brought the people out of Egypt, you shall serve God on this mountain. Then Moses said to God, indeed, when I come to the children of Israel and say to them, the God of your fathers has sent me to you, and they say to me, what is his name? What shall I say to them? And this is what I will preach on tonight. And God said to Moses, I am who I am. And he said, thus you shall say to the children of Israel, I am has sent me to you. Let's pray. Father, we thank you so much for your many blessings. And God, we thank you for the wonderful privilege and opportunity to be in your house tonight. God, I just thank you for the continuing protection you put upon Cowboy Church. Thank you, God, for building a hedge of protection around this church in every way, around it physically with concerning COVID, around it spiritually, God, and around it in every way. Thank you so much for watching over Calvary Church. Bless our time together. Bless our Bible study tonight. We ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
You guys can be seated. Moses meets Jesus on the holy mountain. It won't be the last time that they'll meet on the mountain. Remember the Mount of Transfiguration. I've always wondered if Moses and Elijah met Jesus there to talk about the cross. I've always wondered if Moses might have said to him, "Well, Lord, it's just like old times, isn't it? And here we are on the mountain again. Here we are talking again." And so he sees him in the burning bush. Here's what I want you to hear first off. And I am going to be brief tonight. Y'all hang on. We're going to put the gas pedal on this thing. And not for any other reason, but just because. Here's the deal. Here's the deal. The first thing God says to you, "I heard you." There's lots of times in your life when you're going to wonder, "Lord, are you hearing me?" Has anybody ever been there before?
Yes.
I always think about the little girl raised on Prairie View Road down in the heart of DeVille. And a friend of mine, Charlotte Skull, tells this story. The little girl had broken her doll. And she'd been praying about her doll and about that doll getting fixed. And she got tired of praying that doll not getting fixed. And she went out on the porch and she hollered out, "God, do you hear me?" I'm going to tell you what, that was a little 2-year-old girl with a little doll, but everybody in this room, if we'll be honest about it, there have been a time when we just wondered now, "God, are you listening to me? Are you hearing me?" And the fact is, the text teaches us, "I'm hearing you. I hear you loud and clear." Not only that, "I see you." Not only do I hear you, but I see you. My favorite "I see you" story is the story of Ishmael and Hagar. Remember that one? Had all kinds of problems, high drama. We don't need to go into all that. But they left out there in the wilderness. And as they're sitting there, she's over here and she's so sad about the fact they have nothing to eat. That Ishmael's going to belly up and die. And then she's going to belly up and die because they got nothing to eat. They're out there in that wilderness and she don't want to look at him while he's dying. And so they're out there. And the Lord, once again, the angel of the Lord in all caps, pre-incarnate Jesus. Jesus didn't get his start in Bethlehem. He's been around forever. Okay? From the going forth, from everlasting unto everlasting, he shows up in some of the best and coolest places in the Old Testament, like that fiery furnace and a couple other places, right?
Yeah.
So he shows up to old Hagar, and at this place, when he gets through talking to her and comforting her and taking care of her, you know what she called him? Oh, this will give you goosebumps now. The way it says it simply is, "He's the God who sees me." When you dig a little deeper into the original language, you realize what she's saying is a little bit deeper than that. She's saying, "He's the God that sees me seeing him. He's the God that sees me seeing him." Wow. So God hears me and God sees me. So when you're in bed at night or you're on the side of that bed or you get up in the morning and you're praying, and you're wondering, now look, there's 7 billion other people on this planet. God's got lots to do today. He's awful busy. Does he see me? Does he hear me? I want you to know he hears every word. He sees every action. He knows your broken heart. He knows the problems that's going on in your life. And get this, not only does he hear, and not only does he see, but he's also ready to take care of you. He takes care of you. You know the Bible says he takes care of the birds. You know, I've been watching the birds. I ain't got time to chase this rabbit. Put that rabbit back down. Oh, he stuck his head up again. Here we go. You know, I'm like, man, I have been looking at the birds in my yard. Blackbirds showed up today. I love them. Man, because that's some good preaching right there. They've got blackbirds and robins. Blackbirds and robins learned this lesson about them. It says, "Behold the fowls of the air." Listen to this. They don't stop unless they've got something to eat. Unless they feel safe. If you want to grow a church, you will learn that. Then you got the geese. One day I counted 32 groups of V's of geese crossing over our little place. I thought, wow, think about how God takes care of them. And then Michael saw some buzzards.
We got buzzards on nine wheels, bro. Anybody ever see Josie Wheels? If I'm in a Capitol church and y'all don't know who Josie Wheels is, I'm gonna quit and throw it out, alright? Well, Josie Wheels, remember when they killed the bad guys and his partner said, well, we all bury him, Josie. He said, what?
The buzzards got eaten.
Same as the worms. And I just tell you tonight, and when you brought the youth in, this is what you had in mind, right? Okay, well, I just want to make sure. I just want to make sure we're on the right page here. Can I tell y'all tonight that he takes care of the birds, he's going to take care of you. So I just wanted to get that out of the way before we get into this audacious I am lesson. And we're going to get this, this is 4 gears, man. We're going to get through this. I got 4 friends who helped me understand this text over the course of 30 years. They didn't know it, didn't know what was going on at the time. But this text is absolutely amazing. Here's what he says. Moses said, if I'm going to minister in your name, and then God said, well, you are, and you're the minister of Get It Done. I want you to take care of this business. I want you to get my people out of bondage here. And he says, well, all right. And he said, well, when I go to them, they're going to want to know what's your name. They're going to want to know. I mean, there's other gods. The other gods got names. There's Marduk. There's Baal. There's all kinds of gods in the Old Testament. What's your name? What am I going to tell them? And then his answer to him is, well, all right, if you need to know my name is I Am. I Am. In this deal, he says, you tell him I am who I am, and that I am has sent you. It's the being verb. It's the being verb. And we'll explain that in just a minute. It is God's personal name. God's called all kinds of good stuff in the Bible. All kinds of good stuff. But this is his personal name, like Steve. Is my personal name, and Perry is your personal name. This is God's personal name, the being verb, I am. And you say, well, that's kind of unusual. Well, you would pronounce it in Hebrew, and as soon as I say that, I know I'm wrong, because the vowels are missing. Can you imagine reading a text without any vowels in the words? Now, that's what you have in the name of God. And you say, well, why did they take the vowels out of the name of God? I'm so glad that you asked that question. There is a commandment that says don't take the Lord's name in vain. There's an explanation of that says if you do, you deserve to die. We could thin out America's population with people taking the Lord's name in vain. Amen?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, that's what I'm talking about. Anyway, I'm not propagating that, but I'm telling you, that's how important the name of God was. They felt that if you misuse this name, if you spoke it in vain, which simply meant empty, if you just made it an empty usage, man, boy, I'm telling you, we got to think about this. I mean, because we're very clearly doing that pretty often. It's not just saying God's name with a swear word. This is just whenever we don't lift up his name in reverence. When you were saying hallelujah, hallelujah is the Hebrew word that means praise the Yah. Praise the Yah. And the Yah is his personal name. It's his holy name that we're talking about. And so the reason they got rid of the vows is they were so afraid of speaking his name in vain, they got rid of the vows and quit saying it. And the reason we don't know how to pronounce it today is because they went so many hundred years without saying it, we're not quite sure what vows are in it. Now people, you know, have put in he's and ho's and all kinds of stuff. And the best guess I've heard yet is Yahweh. I used to use Jehovah, and then I found out there wasn't any J's in Hebrew, and that kind of thing before Luke. You know, I mean, how's it Jehovah when there ain't a J in Hebrew? Messes you up a little bit on Jesus, too, but I'm not going there tonight. So anyway, you know, these names, they started with a Y. And so Yahweh. And so this name was so precious and so important that they were so afraid of saying it wrong or doing something wrong that they protected it. Whoever blasphemes the name of the Lord shall surely be put to death. All the congregation shall certainly stone him, and the stranger as well who is born in the land. When he blasphemes the name of the Lord, he shall be put to death. The Hebrew word for it is Kadesh Hashim. And it meant the holy name. That's what they called it. Instead of saying it, they said, the holy name. Let's think about the holy name. You know, we want to talk about the holy name.
So this is why all of this is so important. When I was growing up and I heard about this I am who I am passage, I thought about Popeye who said it with a Y. Remember that? I am who I am. Well, you know, I am who I am. When I was growing up, and some of y'all are going to love this because you were raised the same way and you raised your kids the same way. When I was growing up and Mom and Dad told us to do something, it just wasn't fitting to say, well, why? You just didn't do it. You know, you didn't do that. That's right. It could go ugly really quick. You know, hey, go do this, go do that. Why I gotta do it? No, that's not what went down. And there was this deal that if you ever had any kind of little insinuation like that, it was this right here. Because I said so. Okay, well, I raised my kids that way. Boy, I ain't got to have no reason. You want me to smack you? Come here, I'll need to chop you in the throat, boy. I said so, and that's why. How about them apples? Take that attitude to youth camp. See how it works for you. I had some little old boy and some little old gal. We got the kids with us tonight. Got a little boy, a little boy, a little old gal. And I get it. They're at church camp. They're in love. They want to smooch a little bit. I'm not against smooching, kind of. You know? Anyway, they out here and they got this thing going on, but you can't be smooching on my time. You understand? I'm the counselor. I'm the big dog here. And I'm coming over here into the student center of Louisiana Tech, and I walk in there, and there's some kids, and there's this boy and this girl there, and I say, hey, get over to your room, son. What's wrong with you? Lost your mind? Go. He said the wrong thing back. Why did you say? Because I said so. Now, you want to call your daddy and ask about why he's driving 140 miles an hour to come get you? If not, you can hightail it. Now I need you to move faster because of the way you talk to me. Now I need you to move faster, okay? So anyway, that was the deal. You know, it's kind of like, I kind of thought God in the burning bush was saying, nunion. Anybody ever heard the word nunion? When we moved, I got tired of moving, and so I took the drawers out of my bathroom, and I unloaded them into a box. That's how you pack right there. Three drawers, all in the box, boom, put them drawers back in, take the rug, put nunion. None of your business on the top of it. None of you, okay? I thought when God said, I am who I am, that he was saying, I want to be vague. I don't want you to think you can control me because you know something about me. And I thought God was saying, that ain't none of your business. I am who I am right there. Was I wrong? Let me tell you what I am means. Hope. Let me tell you what I am means. Dr. Franklin Atkinson, when I was about 25 years old, he taught me my first grade, I am lesson. And I am is the being verb. So, it means I am who I am in present tense on both sides of the equals. Okay? But it could also mean this. Hang on. What I have been, I will be. I said, oh my. What I will be is what I have been. What I am today is what I was in the past, and what I am today is what I'll be in the future. God wasn't saying it's none of your business. God was saying, Moses, son, I just gave you a tough job, but you can count on me. I'm going to take care of you. I'm always going to take care of you from this point and forever. You can count on me. I am the faithful God. You will never have to worry about it. You can depend on me. I am the faithful God. I'm the Lord, the Bible says, and I change not. He never changes or casts a shifting shadow. James 1:17 said, by the way, he doesn't change to accommodate anybody.
Amen.
He doesn't change so that he can be politically correct or, you know, following the guidelines of what people think about him. He doesn't change to include his counterparts. He is the faithful God. He is the God you can count on. And the older you get, the more you know this.
Yes.
The God who's took care of me back under, he's going to take care of me now. Yes. The God who got me through that, you find yourself in the thick of things, you're not, I've been through worse than this. I've been through lots of things worse than this. I'm going to make it to the other side. God brings you to it to bring you through it, is what Drew Brees wrote in the book then. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death. Number two, I am who I am means I am more. That's the second lesson learned about this. Learned this from a young preacher. His name was Andrew Skull. Anybody know Alan Skull? It's his grandson. Paul's son, Andrew Skull. He's a preacher up North Louisiana. I am, and what he was saying was, it was so good. What he was saying was, when you have a blank there, you know, he's more than that. So if you filled in the blank, you would be limited. You know, I am whatever. He's more than that. For instance, I'm holy. Yes, he is, absolutely. But he's more than holy. I'm love, absolutely. Absolutely, he's love. But he's more than love.
Amen.
He's bigger than whatever you want to put in that blank. And even when you have biblical expressions, yeah, he's everything the Bible says he is. But he's more. No matter what you think, no matter what you have in your mind, God is bigger than you think he is. And it don't matter how big you think he is.
Amen.
He's bigger than that. I am who I am. I am more. I'm absent. So I'm the faithful God, and I am more. I love this one. This one comes from Dr. Buddy Greer. He said, I am is the opposite of I ain't. Y'all going to like this when y'all hear what I'm talking about right here. I am is the opposite of I ain't. Can I say tonight that Muhammad is I ain't? Can we say tonight that Allah is I ain't? The Quran is I ain't. Buddha is I ain't. Isn't it fun to pick on them other gods? Yeah. Boy, it is. Marduk, I ain't. Yeah, that's right. Baal, I ain't. Anat, I ain't. Yeah, we pick on all them Roman gods and them Greek gods. Let me tell you something. Our recreational pursuits is an I ain't compared to him. Any kind of addiction that you ever get in life, today or tomorrow or forever, any addiction that you fall into, is an I ain't. Alcohol and drugs will never, ever, ever satisfy you. They will never do anything but hurt you, wrong you, and leave you wanting. How about all the people that think, man, all I need to do is find the right relationship. Boy, if I could just find me a man. There are some women in here
that have never thought that.
Are you sure? Dennis, we hungry. We need to eat. You said you better take it like a man. You better take it like a man. All I was going to say is there are several women in this room who have found a man, and I can tell you it ain't all that. Amen? Amen? That's what I'm talking about. Y'all sitting around talking about, boy, if I could just find a relationship. I want you to know tonight, man, I love my wife, and I love the fact we've been married for 40 years, and she's on and on and on and on and on and on. Last week, I got her a dozen roses, and I sat there for 30 minutes trying to figure out a reason I couldn't find one. I just said, just because. I know you men hate me for that, but that's all right. Eat my dust, brother. That's all I'm saying. Man, when you hanging out with a woman that pretty, you got to stay up. You got to do good. So I want to tell you. Here's what I want you to know. I want you to know relationships are awesome. Relationships are audacious. But they're I ain't compared to the I am. He's got to be first and foremost. I love my wife, but she's got another man in her life. His name is Jesus. And I hope she loves him way more than me.
Amen.
Wow, I'm telling you right now, I ain't. So when we say, I am who I am, he wasn't saying, hey, brother, I'm one of those I ain'ts, because those I ain'ts are not much to them. And then I want to say to you, the last thing I want to say is the only I am is the Lord. He is it. There isn't any other. Stephen Furtick, he's a pastor at a huge, ginormous church. I love him. I love hearing him preach. And he's got this statement about I am who I am. Listen to this. You got to grab it quick, okay? He says, I know I am. I know I am. And he means it two ways. So I just want to make four or five statements. And then I want us to think about, I know I am. But I also know I am. Y'all watch this, okay? I'm a sinner. Are you a sinner?
I am.
I know I am. But I know I am.
There you go.
I'm weak. I don't do just right. I know I am. But I know I am. I've been sick before. I have. And I know I am. But I know I am. Defeated. I know I am. And I know I am. I'm not enough. I know I am. But I know I am. The great I am wants a personal relationship with you. He wants to be with you and in you. And he wants to hang out with you for the rest of your life. Wow, man, I'm missing something here. I am a good one. Oh my goodness. Come on, Steve. Okay, y'all just hold on. When y'all put me in the nursing home, I'd like to go to the okay one over there. I really would like to go to. Aren't you glad you brought the kids in here tonight to see and witness this fiasco right here? This is so good, I can't give up on it. Okay.
Pull out your hat.
Oh my goodness. You know, I came up with another sermon. I thought one night I'm going to dress up like a cowboy and preach on hypocrisy. Oh, man. Okay, well, what it was is the Kingsmen, the Marksmen, they wrote a song called He Is I Am. He Is I Am. The way that it goes, I can tell you some of the lyrics. He talks about how he goes through all the seven I Am's of the Gospel of John, which is why I wanted to introduce this to you tonight. I want us to study the Gospel of John. Before we got into those I Am sayings, I am the vine, I am this good shepherd. Before we got all into all them, I wanted you to know this I Am background. He is I Am. He is I Am. He is I Am. And I am nothing without Him. That's who He is. So the great I Am holds a relationship with you. We're going to have a time of invitation. And you just come and play something. And you feel the leadership of the Holy Spirit tonight, and I'd like to come. You want to come to the altar and pray?